started off by asking a lot of questions. We finished with paradigms, we finished with paradigm shifts. And then we started asking the questions of, so do you know that feeling, right? Remember, do we know that feeling? Like when you go back to that guy, but you don't want to go back to, right? Or eating that extra piece of chocolate cake when you're not, when you're stuffed, or getting upset when you know you shouldn't get upset, right? Remember, yes? Okay. So we ended off with asking, so what's the point of these challenges and why do we keep doing the same thing over and over again? And the answers we were given, we wrote them on the board, were, Sam said, well, it's a challenge, right? This is like a workout, right? So if we still have this challenge in my life, right? If every time this person says something to me and I still get upset at them, then it must be that I need to continue working in this area, right? What else did we say, Daphne and Tzipora? What was the point of these challenges?
Overcoming that, realizing that it's one of the flaws within ourselves that we need to work on, that the reoccurrence of it is teaching us a lesson.
Teaching us a lesson. Joanna, you have anything to add? What's the root of all of these struggles? How would you define these struggles?
Inner, like, problems in
ourselves. Yes. What? So we need to grow from inner challenges within ourselves. What's this thing that's making us mess up so much? What do we call it in Jewish terms? Thank you. Yetzer hara. Yetzer hara. Every single animalistic drive that we have, any single urge or impulse or negative thought that we have, that's just the yetzer hara. It's the yetzer hara. And we tend to think that once this challenge passes, right, once my mother just gets her life together, then life can start, right? Or once my boyfriend gives me what I need, then life can start. Once I lose the weight, then life can start. Once I do this, basically, once this struggle is out of my life, then that's when life starts, right? However, says the Talmud, right? Adam, not the Talmud, sorry, it says in Eob, right? Adam la'amal yulad, right? Man is born to toil. We should, this class, we just spoke about paradigm shifts, right? This class is a total paradigm shift to our struggles, right? We tend to think of challenges as a roadblock, something that's in the way, and once they get out of the way, then I'll be able to move on with life, right? Are we familiar with R&R? Do we know what R&R stands for? Rhymes with less than relaxation.
No.
Think. Yes, thank you. Rest and relaxation, or rest and recreation, right? R&R. You're good. You're good. Rest and recreation, or rest and relaxation. What's R&R? R&R is when a soldier goes to the army. And I had two brothers in the army, and you know, he would like paint for me these like pictures of what they would do, you know, when they were on R&R, and they would like sit there, like, if you can imagine, a bunch of like smelly boys like playing Game Boys or whatever has developed since 30 years ago when Game Boy was still around, right? And like, we used to like joke, like, do you ever work? Like, hello, who's like protecting us, right? But any soldier knows that the point of the army isn't for R&R, right? You don't go to the army to rest and relax. However, during the times when you are not on the battlefield, then you have what's called R&R. It's the same thing in life. Our Yitzhara is constant. Our Yitzhara is here. We will be tested with that guy. I don't know, I've had girls tell me, guys just trip me up. I don't know what to do. My mind is always on boys. Baruch Hashem, you're normal, right? At least it's your mind's on boys and not on girls. Or people tell me, every time I see food, my mind is just food, and food is a struggle for me, and I look in the mirror, and I hate how I look in the mirror, and I look at this, right? And that's always my struggle, right? You could have someone who lost 100 pounds, and she still sees herself as a 300-pound girl, 200-pound girl, right? That's always my struggle. But that struggle, they say in Gemara language, have you heard of L'chachilam b'dievet? Right? L'chachila means it's the, for lack of better words, it's the ideal way, and b'dievet means like, it's mutter, you're allowed to do it, but it's b'dieved, meaning it, because there's no other option, you can do that, okay? For example, let's say I'm going with my family, who not everyone keeps the same, I don't want to say level, but the same kashrut as I do, okay, in terms of labels, okay? So if I call my rabbi and say, listen, we're all going on a vacation with my family and my parents and this, we're eating this hotel, I don't eat this hechsher. What should I do? I'll say, listen, licha achila, if you're able to just want to be a vegetarian for the next 24 hours and just eat the vegetables or just eat the meat or whatever I'm allowed to eat, that's licha achila, okay? That's like the best option. Bidyevet, eat whatever they're eating. Trust me, the food's kosher anyways, right? That's like what licha achila bidyevet means. Clear explanation, kind of definition? So we tend to think of struggles as it's bidyevet, okay? I want my mind to be off these boys. I want me to be able to be happy with my body image, et cetera, et cetera. But our struggles are l'chachila. We need our struggles. We need, God gave us a yetzer hara for a reason. The yetzer hara is called a king. Hashem's also called a king. The yetzer hara, this literally translated as evil inclination. Yetzer means desire, right? We have a yetzer tov, a yetzer hara, right? Yetzer means desire. Hara comes from the word ra, which means evil, but it actually comes from the word disconnected, right? Which comes from the word disconnected, because we have, like, when we blow the shofar, tekiya, shavarim, terua. Terua is 9 broken sounds. If you ask my kids, they say, do, 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 do. Right, that's terua. Ra means, it says in Tehillim, teruim b'shevet barzel, to smash, right, with iron. So it comes from the word disconnected. Right? I'm going on a little slight tangent. When we do a chet, how do you spell chet in Hebrew? Take a guess. Chet. Great. You're 1 out of 3 is correct so far. Thank you. 2 out of 3 is correct. Chet. You would think it's spelled like this, right? What did you say? Dot, no. Hey, interchangeable with the hey is a?
Olive.
Yes, olive. Say it with confidence. Olive, right? Chet. I just did half in script, half not. Sorry. Chet, right? What's a chet? A chet is the olive is totally silent. Olive always represents aloof, higher, right? When we do a chet, right, when we do something that's a sin, that means we are disconnected from the aleph, from that spiritual side of ourselves. The aleph is silent. We can't pronounce it. That was just a tangent about how it chet, the yetzer ra means disconnected also. When we do something wrong, that's not our intrinsic self. Intrinsically, we are good people. But we have this thing called the yetzer hara. God gave it to us for a reason. We're not here for R&R. We're not here for just a break. To just chill out. But then the obvious question then is why? Why is it so hard? Why is God challenging me so much? Why do I have this yetzer hara in the first place? And so a few of the examples we gave was to help us improve ourselves and to work on myself and practice makes perfect and et cetera, awareness, okay? I want us to read something short inside.
My children, I created the evil desire, but I also created the Torah. As the antidote. If you occupy yourself with the Torah, you will not be delivered into the hand or hand or his hand. For it is said, if you do good, shall you not be exalted. But if you do not occupy yourself with the Torah, you shall be delivered into his hand. For it is written, sin crouches at the door. Moreover, he is altogether preoccupied with you to make you sin. For it said, and unto you shall be his desire, but if you want, you can rule over him. For it said, you shall rule over him. Our rabbis taught the evil desire is hard to bear, since his creator called him evil. As is written, for the desire of man's heart is evil from his youth. Rabbi Isaac said, man's evil desire renews itself daily against him, as it is said, every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil every day. And Rabbi Shimon ben Levi said, man's evil desire gathers strength against him daily and seeks to slay him. For it is said, the wicked watches the righteous and seeks to slay him. And where not the Holy One, blessed be he, to help him, we would not be able to prevail against him. For it is said, God shall not leave him in his hand.
Thank you. Okay, in your own words, do you want to explain? What did we just read?
That the evil inclination is sort of innate inside of you, and like the Torah is meant to battle with that. And if you don't, it's like the evil inclination will like overtake you. It's something that we have to constantly be fighting against.
Right. The antidote, right, says, Barati Yetzer Hara, Barati Torah Tavlin. I created the Yetzer Hara, but I created the Torah as its antidote, right? So yes, we're meant to battle it, and the Torah is here to help us with it. Is the Yetzer Hara good or bad? What does it say here? What does it say in the Gemara and Kiddushin?
It's not bad, it's just evil. There's a difference.
Okay, what's the difference?
Hashem created it, so it can't be bad.
Wow, that's beautiful. I never thought of that. Meaning, the word bad isn't a good word. You're saying Hashem created evil. So the fact that God created means it wasn't bad, but it was like it's intrinsically evil. Right. So, beautiful. I love it. That's great. I'm gonna take that home with me. It's evil, right? Does it say that it's a happy thing? Does it say that it's a good thing? Say anything like that? What does the Gemara say? Afilu Yotro, even his creator. It's a desire we can't bear. It's something that says it's on its mind every single day. It seeks to slay us and it seeks to destroy us every single day. This entity that we have within ourselves, what does the Gemara say? It's crouching at the door. Every single person has their own door. So when we say, why am I struggling so much? Why am I struggling so much? What's that quote, right? God doesn't give us something we can't handle. I just wish he didn't trust me so much, right? Like, God, don't worry. He's not gonna mess you up. But it says it's literally crouching at the door, like the Yetzer Hara is here and saying, ah, here comes Nicole. Here she comes. Let me attack her. Let me pounce on her. Oh, here comes Sam. Let me. Right? How can I mess her up? How can I? I'm gonna put a boy in front of her. I'm gonna put this chocolate cake in front of her. I'm gonna put her father screaming at her in front of her. I'm gonna put her bad grades in front of her. Whatever a person's challenges are, Afilu Yotro Karulo. Even its creator called it evil.
But it also says that the Holy One blessed is he. If he did not help the Yetzer Hara, it would not have any power.
Right. So, what's that telling us?
It's telling us that God created the Yetzer Hara in a sense to help us. And the reason why we have Torah as its like antidote is to take what we learn from Torah and veer away from the Yetzer Hara, understanding that even if it comes in our way, we're able to see it.
Amazing, right? Because that's a great point, right? Which what you're saying is, it says that it wouldn't even have any power unless God gave it power, which means if God's giving this thing power, which we believe God is ultimately, eternally, infinitely good, then why is God giving this evil thing power, right? Why is he giving it that autonomy, yeah?
Why do we talk about it as like this thing when we're saying like God is giving it power and God is eternal and infinite in the end, like isn't God just putting the chocolate cake in front of you? Isn't God doing all of this?
Yeah.
So why do we put this sort of intermediate of like talking about it as if it's something separate?
Something separate from a Kaddish Baruch Hu?
Yeah. Like why do we say he's controlling it rather than like he's putting this in front of you and he's challenging you?
It's a good question. I don't want to say it's semantics, because nothing in Torah is semantics. It is the same thing. Meaning God's challenging you. It's not like this little, you know, 2-year-old toddler is like ruining your life and it has all the control over you, right? It's all these, I guess it's the same, this is on one foot. I didn't think about this question, so I want to give a more intelligent answer, but on one foot, I would venture to say the same way we relate to malachim and to angels, and the same way we relate to our parents, and the same way we relate to our sisters and our friends and our boyfriends, it's all from Hashem. It's all the same thing. The same way we relate to Muslim terrorists, right? That's from Hashem also. I remember when the attack happened here in Hanof, my husband said to me, and it was jarring, he's like, this is from Hashem, it's not from them. Like, I'm like, I hate them. He's like, it's not from them. They didn't do it, Hashem did it, right? So it's the same idea, which is everything's from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So why specifically the Yetzer Hara do we give out a divider? I'm not sure. It's a great question. But it could be part of the system and the setup of the world, right? But it is all the same thing. So even God called it bad. It's crouching on the door. It wants to destroy us, right? If God didn't give any power, it wouldn't even have any power. I want to read another thing here.
And it also keeps us on our toes.
What do you mean?
It doesn't let us go through life. It keeps us, like, present.
So So it's funny. Do you think that, or can it be taken both ways? You're for sure right. But what would be, how else can that be taken? When someone's given challenges all the time, what do you see in life? What are the two options? Yeah, meaning fail's hard because you don't really fail. It's just another learning lesson. But you either see people who they consistently rise to the challenge, or you see people who it's Dafka not just not keeping them on their toes, but it's actually like knocking them off their feet. Right? Why? Because we view, and tell me if you agree or disagree, all of you, I'm curious to hear what you think, right? We tend to view, like we said, challenges as this is bidyevet. So I can't do this. I don't have any energy anymore, right? I need more R&R time. Like, stop giving me these challenges. I don't want it. And so I'm just going to sit in my bed and just mope all day. What do you think?
That's a reaction from the Yitzhahara, but I think the purpose of the Yitzhahara, I read a pasuk in Pirkei Avot that said, you can never trust yourself until the day you die. It's basically saying, like, even if you do pass something, like a challenge, don't think that you won the war because it was just a battle. So it keeps you on your toes, like your entire life. You're always thinking like, okay, so I'm kind of slipping up in this when I wasn't so much before. I've got to pay more attention to it. It makes you more cognizant what's going on.
Yeah.
Would it like decrease your ego? Like for something, for instance, like you make me, like for me, I don't know. I like went through this whole period phase where I had no challenges or anything, and I thought I was like on a good track.
Like it's it, I made it.
I'm doing everything right, and things are going great. And then I fall, and I'm like, whoa, that was such a humbling experience. I was so egotistical. Like I was thinking like, nothing can touch me, I'm big and bad, or whatever. And then at the end of the day, like, no, you can't get to her, it's gonna get you again.
Challenges is a great point. Challenges are super humbling. You can ask anyone any challenge, it applies to anything in life. Like, just when you think you made it, and again, we're really giving a paradigm shift to this, because it's not like there's this evil person up there, you know, in heaven with a man with a long white beard who's trying to say, ooh, let me see how I can mess it up today. We're going to try and understand what the point of this is. But ask anyone who has panic attacks or heavy depression or any sort of in that genre, right? The most humbling experience can be when they finally get out of that. And it's a bracha, right, that you start to like forget the intensity of the pain. They say that happens to women in childbirth. I'm yet to experience that you forget the pain, but that's what they say is supposed to happen, right? But so when someone's been through a heavy panic attack or depression, and let's say if they go on medication or they help themselves, whatever it is, and they can like kind of forget what it's like, or they're just like, life is this is great. Then in one moment, if they have an anxiety or a panic attack, or all of a sudden they get hit with this heavy depression, they can be like curled up in a ball crying like a baby, right? Like, where'd that come from? I thought I was past this, right? Or someone can slip up and I'm Shomer Nagia and I'm dating this guy and I'm working so hard. And look, see, I made it. Until one night you just like slip. It was just too hard. It was just the moment. It was just right, et cetera, like, what happened? I thought I was all the way up there, which is why, right, you said in Pirkei Avot, don't trust yourself till the day you die, which is why 95-year-old Gedolim, huge rabbis living in Bnei Brak, follow Tati the laws of Yichud. The Gemara speaks about a big holy Tana who ran. He said, fire, fire, when like a woman came into his house. You're tempted by a 20-year-old woman? No, right? But don't trust yourself till the day you die, right? Who said just because you dealt like that back then means you won't be tested now? And what Sam is saying is correct in the sense, life is like an elevator, meaning you're either going down or you're going up. You never stay the same. So with our challenges, right, they either build us or break us, right? They make us or break us, right? You can either, you're going up or down. It's like an escalator or an elevator. There's no such thing as stagnation. And now we can understand all the more so, because when we see that we constantly have these challenges and we're constantly working out, so then what's going to be of them? Look again at the sheet number 4. Nesivo Shalom Chelek Aleph. Major task of the Yetzer Hara. Do we want to do it in Hebrew, or is English good? English. Okay. Major, that was like a unanimous English. Okay. Major task of the Yetzer Hara is to throw us off balance, distort our thinking, to make us small and think more narrow in a limited fashion. Pause. Whoa, what's the Nesiva Shalom just telling us? What is the major task? What is this major job more than Rabbi Nachman says, more than the Yetzer Hara wants to make us fail, it wants to make us feel bad about the failing, right? It wants to narrow our thinking. What's the job of the Yetzer Hara? I want you to have tunnel vision. More than I want you to have tunnel vision, I want to distort your thinking. The Ramchal says in Mesilat Yesharim, he says that this world is compared to night, to darkness, right? Jews go according to the lunar cycle. We go according to the night because we believe we're still in Gala, right? Sun always represents the day. The secular world goes according to the sun. He says that this world is compared to night in two ways. How? One is we can't see anything. Night is dark. We can't see anything. I don't have clarity about things. I don't understand what's the right thing, what's the wrong thing to do. We daven in Shemona Esrei every single day. God, bring us back clarity, right? Bring us back people who can guide us properly. And he said, even worse than the first thing, how this world is like night that we can't see anything, worse than the first is that we think we're seeing, but we're not actually seeing accurately. I think this is a nice, cute cat, but really it's a tiger, right? I think this is a table, but really it's my kitchen sink, right? It wants to distort our thinking. You know those, you would go to these haunted houses, and they have these like funky mirrors that you go in, right? That's Yetzer Hara. We may not be in the haunted house. We can look at a mirror and be like, I can't believe I look like that. I can't believe I look like that. And did you ever see this powerful YouTube video? I should bring it in. It's a different topic, really, but I'm sure you've seen it. Where you have these artists and they're going to paint. They take, like, let's say 10 people, okay? And they first bring in their friends and they say, can you describe to me what this person looks like? Have you guys seen this? Yeah, you've seen it. It's amazing, okay? It's amazing. Can you describe to me what this person looks like? And so their friends describe, well, she has blue eyes and she's, you know, thin, or she's a bit heavier and her arms are this and delicate fingers, a big finger, whatever it is, and they draw a picture. And they bring in these people, and they put them behind a curtain and say, can you describe to me what you look like? And they describe exactly what they look like. Oh, I have chills just saying this. And they turn the two different papers around, the friend's description and their description, and they're radically different, right? Radically different. Isn't that crazy? Right? What's the major task? What's the major job of the Yetzer Hara? And we're going to speak. We're going to get to, God willing, different ways that it tries to make us trip and fall with depression and with feeling bad about myself and feeling worthless and feeling et cetera, et cetera. Fears is distort my thinking. It's not an accurate picture of yourself, either on a physical level or on an emotional level, okay? Okay, and in a limited fashion. More than any other seduction of evil or holding you back from doing a good thing, the Yetzer Hara would much rather stick its nails into your mind and heart and distract and bother you in ways of thinking and constrict you and make your clarity unclear and make you small until all of your service in this world is through immaturity and small-mindedness. Through everything that you do is through what? Immaturity. I'm 50 years old, but I'm still living like a 15-year-old careless teenager. It wants to cut the wings of your spirituality so you won't be able to fly. Brackets, right? It doesn't want to kill you. Just doesn't want you to fly. What does Yetzer Hara want to do? It's not that it wants to completely annihilate you from this world. It just wants to kind of make us small and like, don't do anything big. Don't be great. Limit yourself. Really, no one's going to really marry you. So if this guy said he proposed to you, just go with him. Right? Just don't like, you know, don't rock any boats. Don't do anything like too wild. Why? Because just stay low. Adam Amayula, our whole job is to fight this. But God, why would you give us this test in the first place? Why would you give us these challenges? And I'm going to ask this question again. Now that we see the Yetzer Hara wants to make us small-minded, it wants to distort our thinking, wants to put our nails in tests, even God called it evil, why would God give this to us again? What are we supposed to do with this energy? What are we supposed to do with this entity?
Actualize it, if you will. But into a or positive what?
Yes, you said exactly what the Shema, what we say in Shema every day. That's the answer. One of the answers. There's a lot, which is Ulav do b'chol levavchem. It said, right? We have to say b'chol levavchem, b'chol nafshachem, right? You should serve God with your both your hearts, right? And everyone asks the question, why is hearts plural? Why are we serving God with both our hearts? And it's exactly what Sam said, which is with both your hearts, the good part and the negative part. Serve God with both of those. We're not trying to squash the Yetzer Hara, right? When we spoke about thoughts, we're not trying to like block out our thoughts and don't think that. Good people don't think thoughts like that, right? Kind of let it be and channel it to something else. What else?
To get control over it.
To get control over it.
Like, because the job of the Yetzer Hara, once you make bitul Torah, like not learn Torah, not do anything that's holy, so you need to get control over it. So if it comes at you and says, oh, you did a sin yesterday, why are you trying to dodge Shimon and Esrei, chakras, you're like, well, I did teshuva for that, and like I can still dive into the Shem, even though, like...
Right, so for us to be the ones who are really managing it, not letting it have total
control
and ownership. Okay. It says in Bereishis, in Genesis, right? Perek Aleph, the first chapter, when it's speaking about the creation of the world, it says, Vayar Elokim et kol asher asa vehine tov me'od. And God saw everything that he did, and behold, it was very good, right? And they want to know, why is God saying vehine tov me'od? All the other days except for Tuesday where it says tov, good, two times. All the other days, it says, and vihine tov, and it was good. Okay? So no stone goes unturned. And we want to know, why is God adding in the words, vihine tov ma'od, and it was very good? What does Mechtav Me'eliyahu Rav Dessler say? He says, and our sages, he's quoting a Bereishis Rabba, he's quoting a Medrash that says, very good is our evil inclination. It's saying, vihine tov ma'od. What is tov ma'od referencing? Tov is talking about the Yetzer Tov. Obviously, the Yetzer Tov, that good side of us, that part of us that says, no, you're worthy and you're wonderful, and the world loves you, and you can do so much in this world, and you can be so much in this world. Of course, that's tov. That's our Yetzer Tov. What's ma'od? What's very good? When God's saying, and he saw everything that he did, vihine tov ma'od, ma'od, very good. That's talking about our Yetzer Hara, right? Our Yetzer Hara is very good. Wait, hold on a minute, right? We just said, afilu yotro koru lo ra. Even its creator called it evil. And now a medrash is coming and telling us that it's not just good, the Yetzer Hara, like we all said. Yeah, it's our battleground. This is our jinn. This is our exercise. This is what's making us be someone and do something. But now you're telling me it's very good? We're together so far? Okay. And our sages said that very good is our evil inclination. It's hard to understand this because elsewhere God called it evil, which is what we just read, right? God called it evil. How can it also be very good? Even though, it's very powerful, from the vantage point of a person, the Yetzer Hara is bad or evil because it makes life harder, from the vantage point of life's purpose, it is very good. Okay, let's pause for a moment. From the perspective of a human being in this world, it's bad or evil or whatever word you want to use to describe it, right? It's forbidden to go to a Shiva house when someone just passed away and said, he's in a better place now. Why are you sad? He's with God. He suffered so much. It's good. Or Gamzula Tova. This too is for the good. Right? I don't remember if I mentioned in this class, but there is two different schools of thought. There's Rabbi Akiva, and there's Nachum Ish Gamzu. Have you heard of these two personalities? Have you heard of Rabbi Akiva? Okay, so the story with Rabbi Akiva is he was going traveling to a town, and he had with him a rooster, a donkey, and a candle. Okay? And he went to find a place to sleep. He couldn't find a place to sleep at night. And all of a sudden, he goes and he camps outside. All of a sudden, a big wind comes and it blows out his candle. He said, Kol ma d'avid rachmana l'tav avid. Everything that God does will be for the good. Okay? Then all of a sudden, an animal came and killed the rooster. And he said, and that's what he had. How's he going to wake up in the morning? He said, Kol mad, this is Aramaic, Kol mad, David Rahman el Tavavid. Everything that God does will be for the good. And also another animal came, a lion or something came and ate his donkey. And killed his donkey.
Okay.
And he said, Kol ma David Rahman el Tavavid. Everything God does will be for the good. The next morning he woke up and the entire city got completely taken over by soldiers and thousands of people died. Kol ma David Rahman el Tavavid. Everything that God does will be for the good. Then there's a personality named Nachum Ish Gamzu, who he had a really, really hard life. And every time something negative or something challenging happened to him, he said, Gam zu latova. Zu means present right now. This too is for the good. Gam zu latova. This too is for the good. And that's why he's called Nachum Ish Gamzu. Everything was Gam zu latova, right? Yetzer tova, our good inclination. So Gam zu latova. This too is for the good. Nachum Ish means a man, like Isha's woman. Gam zu. He's buried up in Tzfat. What's the difference between these two statements?
One's present, the other one's like future-wise.
Bada bing. Thank you. One is right now. Nachum Ish Gamzu is Gamzu Latova. Right now, this is for the good. Rabbi Akiva's like, everything God does will be for the good. Right? Yeah?
What's the difference also that Rabbi Akiva's statement is like, not just this, but everything God does is for the good?
It's more broad.
Isolating, like, this is for the good.
Yeah. Yeah, more broad statement, everything regardless of what happens. But yeah, but in context, Nachum Ish Gamzu would say that about everything. So it wasn't like he would just relate. It was not like he would just say it to things that he viewed as good. He would say he's called Nachum Ish Gamzu because everything to him was Gamzu. But yeah, it's a good point also. The main difference is that Rabbi Akiva said everything will be for the good. I mean, I don't see it right now, but everything will be for the good. Nachum Ish Gamzu, right now it's good. Comes the Mishnah Berurah, comes the Chafetz Chaim, and he says, so which one should we say? Which one should we say, like, when things happen, negative things happen, do we say Gamzu Latova, which is what people say, probably just because it's easier and quicker, right? Then Kol Ma David Rahman Latavavid, or should we say everything Kol Ma David Rahman Latavavid?
The future one.
The future one, why?
Because we don't understand why it's there.
You were Mechavan, you understood the same thing the Chafetz Chaim understood in Mishnah Berurah. He says, you say Kol Ma David Rahman el Tavavid, right? You can say Gamzu Latova. That's a high level. That's right now, this world's compared to night, like we just said, right? Everything will be for the good. You can say this too is for the good if you see it, but meaning, what's Mechtav, what's Rav Dessler saying? From the vantage point of human beings, the Yitzhahara is bad. I don't see why this person should die and now her children are orphans and father has a widow, etc. Her husband's a widow. I don't see why this person has hard family dynamics. I saw this woman yesterday. I've seen her twice already around this neighborhood. Every time I see her, she is a single woman and she has this daughter. Okay, there's some family. You could tell that she's a single mom. You could tell there's something there. And I've seen her swear at this 3-year-old daughter. I've seen her yell at her. I've seen her like aggressively pull her. And I saw her again last night. And I remember thinking, whoever says, right, like everything fair doesn't mean equal. People think everything is fair. Teachers should treat their students fair. Fair doesn't mean that everyone gets treated the same, right? So when people say, well, God isn't fair, you're right, but God is fair in the sense that he gives everyone what they need. I'm like, this girl, she's born into such a disastrous home, right? From the vantage point of a human being, that's not good. I literally wanted to cry. I couldn't focus on anything else when I saw, I just want to take this child, right? Just like this cute little girl, like take him, like come live with me. Right? You don't say, well, to the girl who comes to Latova that you have this messed up family. You don't say that, right? Sort of Dessler, we'll finish with this. From the vantage point of a human being, it's bad because it's hard. And we don't pause and we don't give halachic ruling that you should see in this moment that it's good, right? But from the vantage point of life and life's purpose, the Yitzhahara is not just good, it's very good. It's Tov Ma'od. Because the right ma'od, tov ma'od, like it says, is the same letters as, take a guess. If you take the first letter and the second last letter and the first letter, what word does it make? Adam, right? Adam. Man, right? Tov ma'od, that yetzahara, that ma'od, that very good, that challenge is what makes the Adam, is what makes the man. Because the purpose of the whole world and the skies above and the world below is to reveal the holiness in the world through using our, this is the key word, free will. And that's only possible in the battle against the Yetzer Hara. Every single challenge that we have, every single struggle that we go through, what opportunity do we have in that moment, an opportunity to actualize our free will? And even if a person chooses evil, God forbid, right? Even if I messed up, which is what we are going to do because we are human beings. There will, you're right, there's going to be consequences because we live in a world of rewards and consequences. That's just the way the world functions. And that will also be working to fix him, meaning that's also good when he messes up because he will learn from the consequences, right, about God's justice in the world, and that too is sanctifying God. I mean, even when we mess up, that's good. So we asked the question in the beginning of class, what's the point of these challenges? To grow, to help us work out. Yes, Adam la'amal yulad, man is created to toil. And then we write inside, what's the Yetzer Hara trying to do? Is it good or is it evil? And it says, even God called it evil. It's bad. Then we read the Nesiva Shalom, which said, what does it want to do? It wants to distort our thinking. It wants to make us narrow-minded. It wants to make us small-minded, right? Then what's the point in it? And then we said in Bereishis, it says, Vayalokim, it's kol asher asah v'hineh tov me'od. God saw everything that he did, and it was very good. Good is the Yetzer Tov. Very good, amazing, perfect, that's Yetzer Hara. Why? What is the challenge of the Yetzer Hara? What does that challenge propose to us and give us the opportunity to do? To actualize our free will. Which is why I think it was Sam who said it before, which is, it kind of keeps us on our toes, which it does. It keeps us on our toes. Then we ask the question, well, but some people kind of knocks them off their toes, right? Kind of knocks them off their feet. That's exactly what he's saying. It's the opportunity for free will. It's that moment, that challenge where I get to actualize my ma'o, which is I get to actualize my adam and utilize that aspect that God gave to me. So when people say, listen, I'm human, right? I'm human. I didn't have a choice, right? I read from Leanne Rimes and Cameron Diaz, two different actresses and singers, right, who wrote articles. They both cheated and were cheated on, okay? And they both said two different statements, which is like Cameron Diaz said, everyone cheats, that's just the way the world works, there's nothing bad about it, we're human. And Leanne Rimes said, we fell in love, we're human, there's nothing we can do about it. They both cheated on their married spouses and fell in love with each other. And whenever I think about that, whenever I read that, it's part of a certain class that I give, I'm like, you're right, you're human, but you're totally going against what it means to be human. The point of these impulses, so you're attracted to someone else, so you want that chocolate cake, so you want to yell at this person, so you want to speak negatively, but that challenge is not, see, I'm human, now let me give into it. It's, see, I'm human, now let me use my free will to bring that out. Clear? All right, have a great Shabbos, everyone.